Maybe you can just lead us in those.
Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and which is what Elijah has accepted to do so. I'm really glad that we're here. So let's worship God first, and then we'll share a little bit of Word of God, and then we'll have the actual baptism, and which will be hopefully done within an hour, less than an hour is the idea. But I'm going to invite our MGM worship team to come and lead us with some songs. A couple at least, one or two. One is good, too, please.
Yeah. needs and yesterday I was at my uncle's house. His name is Moses, and they bought a new fridge. So the guys came and they just dropped off the free fridge and they gave some instructions. And the one thing they said, it will take 2 hours to cool the fridge, right? So it takes about two hours. The only thing we need to know, we need to do is just to plug it in. And that's because it comes from comes the power from, like, electric from, electricity from. The reason I'm saying is, once we plug in our faith in Jesus, that very moment, Holy Spirit comes in us. It will take a little time to cool us, especially on Anchorage Raj. It will take a little bit of time. You may have a lot of questions, but you will not understand right away. But slowly, once you start cooling off, you will get everything. And it's ongoing process. It's never stopped. Even for us, we have a lot of questions, confusions. But one thing I want to tell you for sure, that you are plugged in the right place, and you are in the right place. So, this song is called Pavitra Atma.
Yeah.
you just be comfortable coming reading 8 verses for me? We're going to read from John chapter 3, verses 1 through 8.
Okay. Jesus did a teach in the Nicodemus, but the first is like, now there was a man of the Pharisees, the name Nicodemus, a member of the Jews in the ruling the councils. He came to the Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the miraculous sign you are doing if a God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked, surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. The flesh is a gift of birth of flesh, but the Spirit gives the birth of Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone, both of the Spirit.
Good. Thank you. All right. So I want to just make sure, God's word is always a priority, no matter what the occasion may be. So everybody's familiar, we are familiar with this passage where a person like Nicodemus comes and says, how do you get into the kingdom of God? And it's beyond our understanding to be born again. It's a whole different meaning. But I think I want to just share with you what that means, why that is important, just a little bit, and especially what you are going to do, why that is important. Now Jesus, expected, as we read, Jesus expected Nicodemus. He was like a ruler. He was a Pharisee, like a leader of the Jews. He was a learned person. So it's important that Jesus thought that he should know what Jesus is talking about, right? And what it means to be born again, what it means to enter the kingdom of God. I think Jesus expected him to know. And that is all the more reason why we should also understand why it was important for Jesus to, make sure that Nicodemus knew, right? So water and spirit, there are two things. Water and spirit Jesus talks about. They refer symbolically to spiritual cleansing as well as physical cleansing, okay? In another Old Testament book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verses 24 through 27, God tells his children, meaning the people of Israel, that he will sprinkle clean water on them and clean them from all the filthiness and the idols that they were worshiping and all that. So even in Old Testament, this is talked about. He also says that he will remove the heart of stone and he will give them a heart of flesh. That is what God is talking about. And Jesus wants Nicodemus to remember this passage. And you are a learned man. You know the scripture. You should know what I'm talking about. Because in Old Testament, God has already said this is going to happen. So Nicodemus should have remembered about how the spiritual washing was important, cleansing was important, without which, without having done that, no soul can enter the kingdom of God. That is the idea. So this is where baptism comes in, one of the things, right? When you accept Christ, and I think if you guys don't know, Raj had done that, and the first time Raj came to our MGM service, I was telling him that maybe in the spiritual journey, you may be ahead of a lot of Christians because they have not officially, properly, knowingly accepted Christ. Because we're just Christians. I'm a Christian. I was born a Christian. I own a Bible. I go to church. And that's not what it is, right? So I told Raj that you may be already ahead in the race, if there is such a thing, than a lot of Christians, which is an awesome thing, right? So when you accept Christ as your personal Savior, as a God, Son of God, having baptism is like a public confession in front of people of the faith that you have accepted and of the grace of God, because none of this is possible without the grace of God. So you, what you are acknowledging in front of people by doing what we are going to do, is that you're telling the body of Christ, which is the church family, that I have accepted Christ as my Savior. That is a public confession. Now internally, you've already done it. You're just making a public confession, right? So Jesus was baptized, right? Before he started his ministry, he was baptized to fulfill his Father's will, and he was setting an example for us. So if Jesus did that, one of the things is that we have to also do that. Now, everybody knows this, about the story of the fruit, forbidden fruit. And what the forbidden fruit did was it kind of brought us into the wilderness that you see there in that picture, right? Basically, in Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve ate that forbidden fruit. And it wasn't anything to do with the fruit, it was more about the command of God. God commanded not to, but that was good enough for, should have been good enough for people, right? So that is what it is. So what happened was, because of that, we were separated from God. That's how it worked in that. So in spite of God's mercy, God's grace, you're going to be set here in the Garden of Eden, you're going to be the rulers of the world, He has a covenant with us. We were unfaithful to Him, and we still are, like what we were talking earlier. Even today, we are committing things, and anything that is not honoring God is considered a sin. It could be a variety of things. So by human nature, we have pride, we follow our own will, right? I want to do this, I said so, that kind of stuff. And we deny our God-given responsibilities. I mean, everybody's here giving up their other Saturday morning duties, and they thought this was a God-given responsibility to come here and support Raj and Carol, right, and the family and Dennis. So I think we have to give up God, we have to take on God-given responsibilities, but sometimes we don't. We invent our own values, meaning like everybody has their own personal standard. That's the idea, right? We always make our own standards, and we consider ourselves above those people. So all of these things, whatever they may be, that keep us away from God are traditionally called sin, and sin separates us from God. So now what happens is there is grace that comes in. By our own ability, our own works, we cannot do anything. But grace steps in, right? The good news is that while we have turned away from God, God has not abandoned us. That's the most important thing. No matter how low you feel, no matter how dirty, no matter how sinful, no matter how depressed, whatever the case may be, God will never abandon us. The meaning of Christ Jesus, Emmanuel, the word Emmanuel, when you read the gospel, it says God is with us. So God graciously and continuously, after that first thing that mankind did, He seeks to restore us. He seeks to restore the fellowship, the relationship that we have. And God reaches out. We cannot reach Him, but He reached down to save us, to save the mankind. So, here's the thing. Christ came into this world to restore our relation with God Himself. And that was the only purpose of Christ, to make that happen. God came. He came as Jesus Christ, so we can know who God is and what God wants us to be. And I'm so glad, Raj, that He reached out to you and to all of us as well. So knowing God, what does it do now? It makes us aware. Once we know God and the holiness of God and the rules and standards and the Word of God, what it does is it kind of makes us aware of our sinfulness. You know, when you compare it to a standard, you're not meeting it, right? It makes us aware of our weaknesses. And His grace, though, in His mercy, He keeps us, He gives us the capacity to respond to God in a divine love. So baptism reminds us that God has offered us a free salvation. It's a free thing. None of the works can give us. You can give donation, you can give charity, you can do humanitarian, you can do volunteering, but none of that will save us. But when you accept Christ as your Savior is when salvation is offered to us. So God is present in this action that we are going to do. He's present in this action of baptism, and it has to be accepted by us in faith. When we do baptize, it's not just like, okay, currently I mean, that's not it. We have to accept that in faith, basically that Christ, the presence of God, is within that act of baptism, right? God is present here, right here, right now. We have to accept His presence. And the act of baptism does not convey grace like magically, like Punayakia, I'm fine. No, that is not there. It's not a magical thing, but it is actually a powerful channel that God's love is going to flow into your life and through your life to others, and that's the idea. So what is baptism? Really quick, I want to go over a few quick things. Baptism is an outward testimony, like I said, to an inward transformation. Something has changed inside you when you accepted Christ, and you are making a public testimony for that. That's the idea. Okay? Then it says, well, baptism involves dying to sin. Dying to sin, meaning like, you don't want to commit suicide, that's not the idea, but that you are going to put a stop to your old nature. The things that you used to like to do, which dishonor God, you are going to be dead to that stuff. No more Raj doing this, or no more Tony doing what I like to do. And priority becomes God, number one. So that is the idea. So it involves dying to sin. Secondly, baptism is a covenant which involves promises and responsibilities between God and His people. So you're making a covenant, you're making a promise. With God is making you some promises, that if you do this, what will happen? And you're going to have certain responsibilities, and today that person being Raj. So not only it's a contract or covenant that connects you to, you and God, but also us as a community, right? Baptism is like an initiation. Have you heard the word initiation? When you join a membership, when you join a church, when you join a, heaven forbid, like anything, they have this initiation process. I mean, think about this as your initiation into a life of Christ. Third, baptism has forgiveness of sin. In baptism, God offers and we accept forgiveness of sin. Once our sins are pardoned, we who are separated from God are now freed from guilt, and now we are freed from the penalty of sin. That's the biggest thing, because the Bible says wages of sin is death. And that is what Christ is freeing us from. No more our sins are going to lead us to death. Instead, accepting Christ is going to lead you to an eternal life. And that is the most important thing you should know. Our relation with God is restored. And when we get baptized, basically we are professing that now I'm one back into the gospel, right? Now, the next one is baptism as new life. Baptism is a sign of new life through and in Christ. And I think we talked about it a little bit up front, is how the new thing, what you used to do before, now all of a sudden you're going to start thinking differently. You're going to respond to people differently. You're going to respond to situations differently. And that is what this new life is. This is where we identify us as being born again. You are a new person. You know, Nicodemus said, well, how can you be born again? You cannot crawl back into your mother's womb, you know. You cannot be born again, a grown man, right? But Jesus said that's not what it is. It is a different thing, and I think there's going to be more about born again. We can talk later. But by the work of grace, that is possible. So in baptism today, we die to our old nature, which was dominated, which was ruling over us, which was sin, and now we enter into the life of Christ. And that's what we're going to do, full transform. So baptism and holy living. The last point is the baptism. Baptism brings us closer in relation with Jesus Christ and shapes our lives. Basically, it's going to shape how and who we are and all of those things, and it makes it conform. It brings it in conformity with His, God's divine plan, right? We start living a holy life that pleases our Heavenly Father. Okay, and that's basically what I believe. Next, one thing we have to say is baptism is a gift. It's not something that we earn. It's not something that you can claim that now I'm doing this thing, right? And God, you need to give me. You cannot. Or because God, I've never hurted anybody. Because I've never said a bad word. You cannot say that. This is a gift. It is all that is. There is one baptism and one source of salvation, and that is the grace of our loving God. And we just have to earn that. It's nothing that we did. None of us did anything to earn this grace. It is only God in His mercy, right? Okay, next one. It is a responsibility. It's a gift. Now it is also a responsibility, right? Baptism follows with responsibilities for the church and the family, and especially God. So now that I was telling Carol that it becomes her responsibility, auntie and family responsibility, their responsibility to mentor Raj into Christian ways. And how do you mentor somebody? First of all, you have to live yourself. So it also puts a little pressure on you that you have to live according to Christ's teachings. Prabhu Yeshu is equally Baba Chalso. How to? You cannot just verbally say something and then do something different. It will never affect. And that's good for all of us. It's not just family, but as a church, as a family, after the new person, meaning Raj, is added to this church, is a, and I'm not saying membership, I don't mean that. All I'm saying is you're added into the body of Christ, meaning fellow brothers and sisters and believers. But whenever you worship in the name of Christ, it's considered body of Christ. And you are being a part of that through this baptism. But it is necessary for the church to help you in this lifelong process. It's not going to be done in the next week. Nothing like that, right? I'm going to meet this person and that person, and I'll talk to him and her, and I'll meet that pastor. No, it's a lifelong process. And I told you, it also becomes the opposite, where you would be also mentoring Carol and Dennis as a father, and now a husband in their family. So it also becomes your responsibility. It is truly said like this, that if you want to go fast, and you were alone, somebody said they came 85 today. If you want to go fast, go alone. That's what it says, right? But if you want to go far, go together. That's the idea. So when we say far, think about our journey is to eternity. And we have to be together. We cannot do that alone. I just want to run, and I'm a Christian now, and I want to be, I'm going to turn around and say, whoa, where is everybody, right? So the idea is that, we have to go far, and we can only do that by when we're together. So now, finally, the responsibility of the person being baptized. Those were things the family and the church has to do but for you. So today, Raj, as you profess this faith in Jesus Christ, and you are committing yourself to be a disciple of Christ, that is one of your responsibilities. You're going to live accordingly. So you have a few responsibilities as well as a few privileges. You have some privileges to earn those blessings and receive those blessings. And also as a membership of the church, when you are as a part of the body of Christ, it basically, the church is telling you that we'll be with you in times of good and in times of bad times. Whatever they may be, they will be with you. They will pray with you. They will pray for you. And that's the idea of that. But you have to be a part of that. Your responsibility is being a part of it. Man is meant to be living together in society. So Raj, you should know that in this journey, you have begun a journey that is not just going to become easy, it's going to be challenging. More challenges are going to come your way. The day you decide this, plan is already laid out, some challenges. It is a life where there are going to be changes that are going to be needed. Chances are going to be taken. As the Holy Spirit will reveal to you, you're going to grow stronger in faith. You're going to rely on God. You're going to show appreciation to Jesus Christ. And I'm speaking to Raj, but it's for all of us. If you guys have not heard this, or if you have not accepted this, this is for everybody. After being a Christian, after accepting Christ, we have to have a strong faith. It will reveal a strong faith, showing appreciation. And important thing is that today, what we are going to do now, and even after, when we go for lunch, we have to find reasons to celebrate. As body of Christ, we don't have to be always sad. We don't always have to be serious, long-faced. I'm going to church. I have to get up early at church. You have to find reason to celebrate. Even going to church should be a celebration. In your household, it should be like, she should be excited about going to Sunday school. You guys should be excited to go listen to the Word of God, stuff like that. And then when you get together, obviously, there's more, But celebration in a very different, bigger purpose. I'm not just talking about a party, right? So this is an occasion, an opportunity for the congregation to remember. This is not for you guys. I've said enough to Raj. But for the rest of us, for the congregation, it is a challenge right now. It is an opportunity to remember your baptism. You have to remember when you took that step. You have to reaffirm. You have to affirm God's grace and God's work in your life. So you have to start thinking about that. When was that? Has it happened? And am I grateful enough to the Lord for doing that work of grace? So we are also being part of God's story along with Raj today. Together with Raj, we'll await for this final moment. And Raj, the final moment is this, not when we're done with lunch today, but final moment of grace is this, that Christ is going to return in His glory. That's what it is. That's the final moment we're waiting for. Until that day, we are given this charge. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20 say this, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded Now, I am doing what he has told me to do, but he also becomes a part of all of you, and anybody can do that. You can don't even go to the end of the world, but your neighborhood is good enough, your work is good enough. Do that, teach others about Christ, and then it says, and remember, I am always with you till the end of the age, right? So, last point. This is a very confusing verse, and I'll end with this right now. And the wind blows where no one knows. What does that mean? What is Christ telling me? I think the point that the Lord is illustrating here is a very familiar example from nature. It's like a nature thing, right? I'm not talking about tornadoes, I'm talking about just wind that is blowing, right? It says the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from, where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. I told you outside, you don't have to walk around with a badge now. I'm baptized. I'm Raj, I'm baptized. You don't have to walk around with that. People don't have to know that. Just like the wind, people don't have to know that you are baptized by something like that. But basically what it says is that the wind that cannot be controlled, it blows where it wishes, and though the direction, general direction, where it comes from, where it's going, you do not know that, you do see what the wind causes. You do see the result of the wind blowing, right? Like you can see what's happening there. So the wind's effects are being observed. You can observe the effects of wind blowing, right? And that is the same thing in the nature of the Spirit that is brought into you right now, given unto you. It is the same true work of the Spirit. His work that he has begun in you, now in your life, in your heart, it cannot be controlled. Nobody can predict 10 years from now what Raj will do, but its effects will be seen in a transformed life. And that is what I challenge you on, that your life should be transformed. That should tell people something different about Raj. Okay? So this must happen for Raj, this must happen for all of us. The people around us should see us in our transformed lives. We should be living a holy life that honors God in what we do. And pray. I just want to tell you about one quick story to encourage you. I have another very good friend of mine, a Hindu person. He was from Brahmin, like some high level. His father was actually a temple pujari, Amit Patel. He came to Christ for a very different reason. He liked a girl in the college, and he followed that girl wherever she went. So she started attending Bible study in college. So Amit went there in Bible study, but I don't know how much he was listening, but he was basically interested in the girl. So finally, when the girl was approached by him, he says, the girl very clearly told me, I have nothing to do with you unless you know Christ. If you know Christ, then we can move forward, if not. So he says, for that reason, he accepted Christ, he started. But then, you know, once, this is how God's word is, it's a living word. Once you accept Christ, he does what he does. The word does what the word does. Nobody has to like hammer you and chisel you different shape, right? So what happened in his case was he accepted Christ, he started living, but he was afraid to tell his parents. Because his parents, you know, pujari, right? Big, I mean, there will be like repercussions and there will be some fight back at home. But 2 years, he said he kept it secret from his family. He never said anything. After about 2 years, his mother one day called him and said, I mean, come over here. I want to ask you something. What's different about you? You're not like before. She goes, you were so different before, but lately, last few months and a year or more or something, I've seen you totally changed. Something is very different about you. And that's the opportunity Amit took. And Amit says, it's Christ. Everything in his life had changed for his mother to realize that something good has happened in Amit's life. And that's what it is. No labels, no bada cross, you know, not needed, okay? But truly, internally, I told you that God sees the heart, not the outside, right? So let's go back, give us 2 minutes, let's pray, and then we can go back, and if you want to lead them in a short song, like something that everybody knows by heart, give us about 2 minutes, okay? But let's pray before that. Heavenly Father, thank you again. Thank you for your grace. Without grace, Lord, we would not be even standing here right now, breathing right now, alive right now. It's only through your grace and your mercy and your compassion you are reaching out to us and saying, I want you to be on this planet for a purpose. Today you have a purpose added unto Raj's life. Today you have added a purpose in Carol's life. Today you added a purpose in Janice's life. Today you added a purpose in Aunt Evie and their family members, as well as us as MGM team, our group. Lord, you added a purpose. Now we have to start mentoring, training each other, training, helping Raj to grow, and maybe learn from him. There are things, good things in him that we need to learn. But I pray, Lord, that you would open our eyes so that we may see those things around us. Those are your blessings. And we thank you for those blessings around us and in people around us from whom we can also see examples of Christ. Thank you for bringing this day, this moment in Raj's life. First of all, also to getting them together as husband and wife. His new responsibility, Raj, as a husband, as a father now, and as a family member. I pray that you would help him, guide him in all of those things. I pray that you would be with the rest of the family members and help them to stay focused in all the things that come ahead, now the challenges that come ahead, and that their focus would be on you. And I pray for our MGM team as well, Lord, that thank you for having them take this time out to be with us and celebrate this occasion, a very big milestone in the life of Raj. Okay. So thank you again. Be with us for now and in the days ahead. I just pray, Lord, guide us, protect us, keep us safe. Let our feet never waver out of your path. And we ask this in the only name where all things are possible, and that is Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Amen. So, right, let's go back and then we'll come back in about 2 minutes.
Sing a song number 376.
Yeah. friends, brothers, and sisters in Christ. Moment, my God, this is even a blessing for me. And thank you, Carol, thank you for giving me this opportunity. But I'm really glad for you. I'm glad for the family. So Raj today is professing his faith in Christ in front of the church, in front of the body of Christ. So Raj, I have a couple of questions for you. Do you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Do you put your whole trust in His grace?
Yes.
Okay. And do you promise to serve Him as your Lord?
Yes.
Great. And you're ready. And then I want to ask that to the church as well. Church, do you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Do you put your trust in His grace?
Yes.
And do you promise to serve Him as your Lord?
Yes.
So now I baptize thee, Raj, having authority from the Almighty God as a testimony that you have entered into a covenant to serve Him. And in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, I baptize thee. Give Jesus a big round of applause. Until the day Jesus Christ returns again. Amen.
Amen.
So you got your she was very
Every Sunday,
1 p.m. after.
That's a
used
big
to
place.
Be once a month, I would bring it.
Right.
So,
oh, yeah, you can't compare.
Outdoor presentation.
You're going to harvest.
Yes.
Can't compare.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, can you
ask?
Now we are all together.
Yeah.